Welcome, everybody. There we go. I know we're Catholic, but we can do this, you know? We can do this. When I say God is good, I want you to say all the time, God is good. And all the time. Amen. Hallelujah. So just to introduce myself, I am Father Emmanuel Mansford. I am a member of a religious community called the Franciscan Friars of the Renewal. We are based in New York City and various other places. I am not, however, from New York City, as you're probably wondering. Originally from London in England. I joined the Friars in 1998. And I'm currently serving as the vocation director for the community, and I live in Harlem. I'm also here with one of my brothers, Father Michael Kimiotek, and he is the superior of, we have a house of prayer, which is about 2 hours north of the city, so he lives a little bit outside of the madness, which is a blessing. So it's wonderful to be here with you. We're expecting a number of other people to come. I think the weather's been pretty crazy, so some people are just delayed. But this is, I think, is really exciting. It's the first ever Catholic ecumenical track at the Onething conference. You know, woo! Yeah, yeah. And it's something new, you know? I just heard about it a couple of months ago. Just happened to pop in to see Father Michael, and he says, "Hey, I'm going to this thing." And I said, "Wow, that sounds awesome." He says, "You want to come?" I said, "Sure." So I got talking with Keith, and now I'm your MC. So that's how we Catholics do things, you know? The Holy Spirit just kind of guides us. But the word when I flew down from New York this morning, the word that came to me as I was thinking about this was just providence. You know, that God leads us through these things. This is very new. It's new for IHOP, which Keith will explain about in a minute. It's new for the Catholic Church, you know? And some of these things, they're just kind of new. And it was fascinating to me. I was waiting at the gate at LaGuardia Airport this morning, and this man comes up to me. He said, "Are you a Franciscan?" And I said, "Yeah, I am." And so he starts talking to me, and we start just sharing. But he's on his way down to the conference as well. He's a Protestant minister. And he said, "Oh, I've heard Father Benedict Groeschel speak. Do you know him?" Father Benedict Groeschel was our founder. So we have a nice little conversation, and he gets on the plane, I get on the plane. Then I speak to this other lady, Brenda. She's sitting in front of me. She's also down here for the conference. So I get here, and I'm thinking, "Oh, who's going to pick me up from the airport?" So I phone Keith, and obviously they've got loads of things going on. I say, "Oh, well, I'll have someone do it." And Brenda says to me, she says, "We'll give you a ride." You know? And for me, it was providence. I didn't know how I was going to get here. And it's just God, his leading, you know? And that's what I would encourage each of us just to be open to as we begin this time together. You know, the leading of the Holy Spirit, that comes, sometimes we just come to things like, okay, I don't know what God's going to do. But he has wonderful things in store for us. And I was really blessed, you know, by Brenda's kindness. Friars, we don't have cell phones. So I'm standing there thinking, who's going to pick me up? And she says to me, "Hey, have you got a ride?" I said, "I think so." And she said, "Well, do you want to call?" I was like, "I would love to call." You know, like, so I use her phone. Then she says, "Don't worry, they don't have to send someone. You can give a ride." And that's ecumenism. You know, it begins with friendships, with relationships. So each of us is here because the Lord wants us to be here. And we're very blessed, Father Ken Riley and Father Adam Johnson from the Diocese of Kansas City, St. Joseph, are here with us for a little bit. So welcome, fathers. Good to have you with us. In a few moments, we are blessed to have with us Audrey Assad. She's going to be leading us just in a time of worship, just to kind of set our hearts and minds right before the Lord. We've all traveled from different places, and we need just to kind of come into God's presence and calm ourselves and allow the Holy Spirit to take over. So Audrey will lead us into a time of worship. And then we're blessed we have with us Dan Burke. He's the editor of the Catholic Register. I'll explain a little bit more about him. He also has written a number of books on kind of a deeper life of prayer. So he'll be speaking to us about hide and seek prayer. So living a deeper life of prayer Then I also just want to introduce, and if they could just briefly come up, maybe, and just explain who they are, Father Michael Kimiotek and Dr. Mary Healy. They will be just on our panel on prayer. So, Father Mike, if you want to just, and Dr. Mary.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Dr. Mary Healy. I teach scripture at Sacred Heart Major Seminary in Detroit. And after doing that for 8 years, I still can't believe I get paid to be in the Word of God all day, every day. It's such a privilege to do that. And I've been for many years in the Catholic Charismatic Renewal. And I have had a passion for unity in the body of Christ for really all my life. I've gained so much from my Protestant brothers and sisters. I've learned so much, and I still do, from them. And I know there's a lot that they have to learn from us as Catholics and from the heritage of 2,000 years of the Holy Spirit working in the church. So I'm really excited about the small beginning that's here at this conference, brothers and sisters worshiping the Lord and praying and listening to the Lord together.
And I'm Father Michael Kimiotek, and I'm a friar of the Renewal, as Father said. I've been a friar in vows for 25 years now, and I've lived many places. And one of the places I lived was England, and amazing to work with other Christians in England, much more so than I've experienced in America. And that was kind of a little bit of the inspiration even to come here, to see, wow, what would that look like in America? And very encouraged to also see some of the movements and some of the things I've been a part of in these last week even, of just people getting together and starting to go deeper and share their love of Christ. And I also feel like somewhat of an owing to the Protestant community, because I was a cradle Catholic. But my conversion experience, I would say, happened through the 700 Club. And so, the Eucharist was so key to me. It was always to stay Catholic, but really the experience of Christ, really, I owe to the 700 Club. And so I feel like, well, this is a good way to express some thankfulness back to the Lord. And I'm at, as Father said, I'm at right now a house of prayer where we have some hermitages. And so this passion for intercessory prayer and contemplative prayer has been very close to my heart from the beginning of the community. And so, I hope to share some of that with you. God bless.
So as we invite Audrey up now, let's just quiet our hearts just for a moment. I'm just going to invite the Holy Spirit to come and be with us. I always find whenever I come to something like this, there's a million and one things to do. There's a million and one distractions, struggles, temptations, worries. And so perhaps we could just bring them to the Lord. Just once again, place him at the center of this conference, of our hearts, of our lives. Father in heaven, we thank you that we can call you Father, that we are your children. Thank you that we can gather as your people, Father, to worship you, to seek you, to hear your voice. Ask that you would send your Holy Spirit upon us now, even at the beginning of this one thing conference, that we would experience your presence more deeply. Help us just to let go of anything that's hindering us right now, anything that's bothering us, just to give that to you, Lord, in this time of worship. Help us to open our hearts, Lord, to whatever you want for each of us during these days. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. wants to speak to each of us right now in a almost a timeless moment. An encounter with the risen Christ, an encounter with the crucified Christ, and with the infant Christ who we're still celebrating this Christmas season. God, you are outside time. We know we can encounter you here. We can boldly approach your throne. Ooh, boldly approach your throne. No shame in your throne. Boldly approach your throne. Boldly approach your throne. Boldly approach your throne. Confident in you. Confident in express our willingness to God this week in being here and, as Keith said, cross-pollinating. It's a beautiful mission. Let's just surrender to the Lord anything He would have us do. Thank you. God, you are so good to us. We want to serve you, we want to love you and seek your face this week. We could sing about the goodness of God for a few minutes. I'm going to teach you a chorus in case you don't know it yet. It goes like this. I put all my grew up Protestant, and one of the things that we used to learn, we talked about trusting Jesus a lot. And if you've ever been healed by the Lord in any way, which I assume that most of you have, if you're here, you know that you have to trust Him to be open to that. It's very, can be sort of terrifying, actually, to open your heart to God. It can feel, if you don't trust Him, it feels like you're being watched, not like you're being witnessed and seen. Does that make sense? If you don't trust Him, then it's intimidating. But if you trust Him, it's healing. It is healing to be seen by God, to be noticed by God. And He notices each individual heart. He notices everything about you and about me. And we're in this room, a group of people that God is seeing together and individually, so specifically. Well, maybe we could just pray for a few minutes for healing. I think that God wants to do that this week. I know He wants to do that in my heart. I always need healing. I'm sorry to the lyrics person because I'm just going all over the place. But that's the way this event probably is going to go, I would imagine. The Holy Spirit can give you lyrics, right? Maybe we could pray, I mean, yes, for ourselves, but for anyone at this conference who doesn't trust God. I mean, there's so many reasons why that can happen. Trauma, pain, abuse, betrayal. But He wants to right all of that and to heal all of that completely. God, I pray that You would heal people this week. Healing power, Lord Jesus.
Yeah.
we close and get ready for Dan to come up and speak to us, we just pray for an increase in belief and trust and God's goodwill towards us. Trust you. And we believe that you reveal the Father's love. Increase our faith, increase our hope in that and our trust in that, and let us truly have a peace that passes all understanding, no matter what. God, I pray that you would open our hearts to receive your word this afternoon. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I first heard Audrey Assad's music when I was living in the Friary in London. One of the brothers got a CD, and it just struck me because the words come from a deep place. You know, this is someone who walks a journey with the Lord, so thank you. Thank you. Now it's a blessing for us to invite up Dan Burke. Dan is the editor of the National Catholic Register. It's a very fine Catholic newspaper, national newspaper. And he's also written a number of books, or edited a number of books, on kind of a deeper life of prayer. So it's a privilege for us to have Dan join us to speak to us about living a more deep-rooted life of prayer. So let's welcome up Dan Burke.
Well, it's great to be with you. When Keith asked me to do this, I thought he, frankly, was a little crazy. But then he said that I get to do this and participate with Audrey Assad, who I can honestly say is my favorite contemporary Catholic artist. I remember the first song that I ever heard from her was the words of St. Augustine. You remember that song? Restless until, how's it go? I'm restless until I rest. And some of you are starting to sing it. But I love that song, and I love the fact that you have an incredibly talented artist who draws our hearts to God through Catholic tradition. What we're going to do for the remainder of our time together is, one, I want to explore just a bit with you about my own process into mystical theology, into the Catholic realm. And then we're going to talk about St. Teresa of Avila's vision of mystical prayer, and just a little slice of her wisdom that I hope will draw you more deeply to the Lord. My journey began, I'm Jewish by birth, and my journey began, I love this picture because it really illustrates what was going on inside of me as a young man. My journey began in a Jewish home. My father was agnostic, and my mother was a practicing Reformed Jew. But like many Jews and many people of faith, when they begin to suffer, they tend to look outside of their faith for answers. And my mother suffered. I lost my older brother, or she lost my older brother, whom I never had the blessing to meet, but hopefully will someday. She had severe cancer, and her own mother attempted to murder her my grandfather and was put into a mental institution. And my mom, as a young woman, became mom to two of her sisters and caretaker for my grandpa. And so, as you can imagine, that kind of environment breeds quite a bit of pain. And that was passed on to me rather effectively as a young boy. The first aspect of suffering that I experienced as a young man was because of the spiritual darkness in my home. No matter how much my parents loved me, my mother had let in forces that were opposed to my soul and opposed to my sanity and opposed to my life. To top that off, I was also born very sick. I was in the hospital most of my early years. I remember most of my first memories are from a hospital bed. I don't know how old I was, but I remember being very lonely, and I remember the cold steel that they used to have in hospitals, and I remember the masks, and I remember wondering when my parents were going to come back to get me, because I had no idea of time. You know, you sit in a hospital as a little kid, and you're sick. A minute feels like an hour. Days feel like weeks. Weeks feel like months. On top of that suffering, when I was a young man, preteen, my mother divorced my father, whom I loved deeply. The problem with listening to Audrey's music before I talk, I'm a melancholic as it is, you know? Gosh, I don't know if I'm going to make it through. So she married the first Catholic I ever met, who, in between firing a gun in our home in an argument with my mother, beating her into an emergency room and destroying our home end to end, attempted to convince me that the Catholic faith was the one true faith. My friends, I can assure you that is a very poor method of evangelization. And I do not believe it's what the church had in mind. And so all of that suffering nearly destroyed me. When I came to my end of my high school, I went to school in Phoenix and really came to a place of complete despair. Didn't matter how much money I grew up with. It didn't matter how much my parents loved me because they didn't know how. It didn't matter. I mean, I just couldn't do anything to unravel the pain inside of me, the constant pain. The pain and the torture of being rejected by parents who didn't quite know how to love me. The pain and the torture of the darkness, the spiritual darkness my mother left and brought into our home through the occult. The pain of the abuse that came at the hand of someone who was supposed to care for me. And I cried out to God and said, "You got to help me." And it was at that point that I had come to a decision that I was either going to end my life or I was going to figure out a reason to live. I was going to find a reason to live. A bullet or a reason is a good summary. And I think it was at that point that the Holy Spirit said to me, and this is interpreting backwards, of course, "You've seen evil. You know that the spiritual world exists. You've known evil. Maybe there's good that you can find in that world." And so I began to study and read, and I began my research in the area that my mother led me into, which she was, although a Reformed Jew, also into the New Age and into occultic practices. But the New Age movement was very interesting to me because of this all roads lead to heaven idea. And so I began to study mostly in the non-Christian East, and ignored my Jewish roots, which is what you do when you leave your core religion. You think that all the answers are outside. And the other thing that happens, unfortunately, is you think because you've had just a little exposure to what your faith was in your home, that you know it all. Recently, I have a show every week called Divine Intimacy Radio, and all we talk about is prayer and the interior life. It can be found on iTunes, and it'll be on EWTN soon. But my co-host's family heard that she was on the show with me, and the woman asked her, well, what do you talk about? She said, prayer. And she said, what's there to talk about? This is a Catholic woman. And of course, you know, or you wouldn't be here, that you and I could have a conversation about prayer until Jesus comes, and we would never scratch the surface of all that God has for us. So I cried out to God and said, you got to give me a reason. And he said, start looking. And I did. I ran into a guy at Pizza Hut. His name was Mark, first evangelical I ever met. I didn't know what he was. I didn't know what an evangelical was. I didn't know what a Christian was. And Mark shimmied up to me in my first week there and started to help me wash dishes, which I thought was a little weird, but I was happy about it because I didn't want to wash all the dishes. And then, as the week went on, I was heading towards bathroom duty. And I don't know about you, but bathroom duty in a public restaurant is not something that I think anybody looks forward to. And Mark came to me, and I was whining to Mark, of course, about my upcoming bathroom duty. And he said, well, I'll do it for you. I thought, what is going on here? This is a little bit weird. And so he cleaned the bathroom for me that week and every week that I worked at Pizza Hut. I never once did bathroom duty. One time I took him out back because I had come to the conclusion that he was attracted to me. This is how sick I was, right? So if somebody's going to be nice to me, it's because they want something from me. And so I thought he was gay. And in the orientation of my heart at that time was that you solved that sort of thing with physical violence. So I invited him to the back of the store outside to confront him about whatever was going on with this being nice to me thing. And I don't remember what I said to him, but I remember him being very alarmed and exclaiming that he was a Christian and that he was supposed to be nice and that that's what was going on. I learned that Mark was a former cocaine addict whom the Lord had saved, and he told me about Jesus. Now, he wanted me to hang out and talk about the Bible, which I thought was pretty effeminate and goofy, so I wasn't about to do that. But I was affected by Mark. He did draw me in a bit. I ended up leaving Phoenix, still with all the pain and the writhing in my heart. I was drinking myself to sleep at that time, which, as any of you have ever tried that, doesn't work very well. I ended up back in California. And I started listening to evangelical radio. And Dr. Walter Martin attracted me most. I was most interested in Dr. Walter Martin because he was kind of a jerk like me. He was very harsh, very direct. But I loved his scholarly approach because I was an avid reader, and I always liked that he backed up what he said by scripture and passages, and he gave what other people's views were, and he explained why he didn't agree with theirs and why his was the best. One day he let it slip that he was a Southern Baptist. And so I looked in the Yellow Pages, flipped it open, and found the nearest Southern Baptist church, Glenn Memorial Baptist Church, named after a dead guy. Nobody in the church knew who Glenn was. But I had a moment here while we were worshiping that paralleled something that happened to me at Glenn Memorial Baptist Church. I was sitting back there with my family behind most of you, listening to you sing praise to the Lord. When you come from a home where there is no harmony and you hear it, it's transformative. As I listened back behind you, I remember the first time in that little Southern Baptist church that I heard people sing together, but it was song, it wasn't like AC/DC, you know what I mean? It wasn't this weird sort of headbanging, sort of, you know, sick sort of singing together, but it was a singing together rooted in love, and I was blown away by it. And it brought a very hardened heart to tears then and again today. I'm not so hard anymore. So the first time I entered that church, it was really only about this big, maybe a few more rows back. I sat in the back to hide out. And the first four rows filled up, and there were about 15 empty pews and then me. And so you can imagine what the pastor did after the service, because he was a good Southern Baptist, hellfire and brimstone kind of guy. He cornered me and asked me, was I saved? And as you might expect, that was the beginning of my journey as a Jewish boy to coming to know Christ. That pastor loved me like Mark did, with as much fervency, in that he spent an hour of his week every week going over a book called Evidence That Demands a Verdict by Josh McDowell. Have you ever heard of that? Great book. Convinced me that the Bible was reliable. And then moved into, after he talked about the historicity of the Bible, the archaeological consistencies, the internal consistencies, then he moved to the prophecies of Jesus as the Messiah and began to tap into my Jewish heart. And it wasn't long after that that I bent my knee to Christ. I prayed the sinner's prayer, but I didn't, that prayer, I did it because they told me to do it. But my, if I could describe my heart at the time, it was more of, I know who God is now. And he's given his life for me. And I have to give everything back. Everything. So to me, it was an act of complete submission. Well, the best one I could make anyway at the time. And this is where things began to get a little weird for me. I was still that guy on the screen. I was still very confused and wounded and hurt. When you get saved out of hell, you bring pieces of it with you. And I hate to admit it, but I spent 20 years or so working those pieces out. Even recently. But I began a prayer life because that's what they said I could do, because they said that Jesus loved me, and I believed it, and I knew it was true, actually. It wasn't just something that I had assented to. I believed that he was who he said he was. One of the best arguments ever presented, I think, about Jesus in Scripture, and it sort of blew up my all ways lead to heaven thing, was Jesus is either Lord, liar, or lunatic, right? He's a lunatic if he believes that he's God and he's not. He's a liar if he knows he's not and he tells everybody he is. Or he's actually who he claimed to be when he said, before Abraham was, I am. So I began to pray and read Scripture, memorize Scripture. And this is where the Lord aimed me toward Catholic mystical theology. Because what happened to me is I really did have an experience of God. He really did radically change my life. He really did take me out of darkness into the glorious light, as Peter says in his epistle. But then I ran into problems. Because as is normal with prayer, my initial experiences were quite encouraging. But I began to move into aridity. And I experienced desolation, and I didn't understand what desolation was. And these things seemed to be contradictory to my faith, to what I believed. And so I started reading Catholic books. I actually, the first job I got as a Christian was working for a very large, I mean, I started reading evangelical books on prayer, but it was a very large evangelical bookstore in California called Pathfinders. And I read every single book on prayer trying to figure this personal relationship with God out. And honestly, I couldn't find any answers. I read E.M. Bounds, Tozer, gosh, the list is so long. John Calvin was actually pretty moving in prayer, believe it or not. Some evangelicals think he's very dry. But on prayer, he was quite interesting. But I wasn't finding the answers I was looking for, and then I came across a text that was edited by an evangelical. But what he did is he took the writings of St. Teresa of Avila, John of the Cross, and some other Catholic teachers and de-Catholicized it. This was at a time when something like what we're doing here would never happen. So instead of St. Teresa of Avila, he called her Teresa de Ahumada, which of course was her name before she was professed, right? And for the priests, they were no longer father. They were just first name and last name. But as I began to read, I began to discover answers. I learned things like aridity can be, assuming certain conditions are true, aridity can be a call to a deeper kind of prayer. If I could say this to you in another way, the absence of any sensory perception of God can be an indicator that you're actually being called into a deeper kind of prayer. And I thought, well, this is the answer. And so I started to look in his references to see where this was going, where these people came from, because I had never heard of them before. They weren't in any of the post-Reformation books. There was nobody that I recognized. And of course, I came into this very, very deep and pure well of what it means to have a personal relationship with Christ. A truly personal relationship with Christ. In some evangelical circles, there was a problem, I think, with how that relationship is understood. And while we say that we want you to have a personal relationship with Christ, when you begin to describe what that means, it's more about a contract. Did you say a prayer? What was the date? Right? Were you born again? What was the date? Did you say the right prayer? And then I would say, I get that. Because he's very real and present to me. He's changing my life. He actually healed me of some habitual sins that I had before I become a Christian. And I've experienced him in prayer. And also, you know, these are not charismatics, right? So they start going, whoa, whoa, wait a minute. You know, that starts to mess with sola scriptura. That doesn't feel so good. When I ran into the Catholic mystics, what I discovered was a lived reality of the essence of what it means to have a truly personal relationship with God. Not contractual, but knowledge, knowing another person. I know my wife. I adore my wife, by the way. She's sitting here. I'm not saying that just because she's here. I talk like this behind her back all the time. But I adore my wife. I had a wonderful Catholic gentleman. He's a prominent lawyer in the Catholic Church. And I was in a study with all these intellectuals, PhDs coming out the, yeah. So when we started to talk, I talked about this personal relationship with Christ. He said, what does that mean? And I said, well, when you were married, did you have a contract? He said, yes. I said, well, what if nothing happened after the contract? What if somebody just told you about how wonderful your wife was? Now, if you believed how wonderful she was, and you knew all these great attributes about her, how smart she was, how pretty she was, and all of that, but you never talked with her, would you call that a relationship? He said, well, no. I said, what about the deepest level of intimacy between a man and a woman? Can you really know her without that deepest level of intimacy? Well, no. So the opposite of that is what I'm talking about, is personal relationship. And I found that in the saints. Primarily found it in Teresa of Avila. I actually, in reading her works, I thought, oh God, I'm sane. I'm okay. I'm not crazy. I've not just been talking to myself. Not because I was experiencing all, you know, I'm not because I'm a saint or was a saint or none of that, but that this woman really knew Christ in the deepest levels and talked about it so freely and openly and clearly. And so, and of course, she's a Carmelite, right? So she began to draw me in, and her writings were what I focused primarily on. There is an awesome book in the bookstore here called The Fire Within by Father Thomas Dubay, which is a great summary and synthesis of St. John of the Cross and Teresa of Avila's writings. I ran into that book before I became Catholic. But it began to draw me in, to make a long story short, to dig into a central teaching about that St. Teresa brings to us in prayer. I was in the middle of RCIA. I had already been arguing for Catholicism by that time with people in the class who weren't quite convinced. And I called up the head of the RCIA program, who was a Carmelite. And I said, I'm totally cooked. I said, I believe in the magisterium. I believe Christ established this church. I don't get this Mary thing, really kind of freaked me out. I don't understand justification in a Catholic sense, Catholic soteriology. But I said, I believed in the authority of the church, and I'll submit, I'll learn it. This is Jesus' church, so I'll learn it. So he said, well, let me call you back. It's a long story that I can tell you at another time, but the bishop, the archbishop knew about me in the diocese because of another situation. And this was Chaput, by the way, who is an incredible archbishop. And they were given approval to receive me into the church in the middle of summer on July 16th. Does anybody know what that date is? The Feast of Our Lady of Mount Carmel. So Teresa of Avila had a tractor beam on me and pulled me in. I didn't, by the way, even know what a feast day was. And I didn't know what that day was. They just said, hey, you can come. Come next Saturday. We'll confirm you and receive you. So I showed up, and I'm up, you know, on the altar. It was a very big church, so I'm in an area like this. And they said, Dan doesn't have a sponsor. I didn't even have a sponsor in RCIA. Will anybody volunteer? And this little old guy in the front said, I'll do it. So I was received and confirmed on the Feast of Our Lady of Mount Carmel. One of the most beautiful analogies that the mystics use to help us understand the work of God, the presence of God in us, within us, around us, is this idea that our soul is like a garden. St. Teresa in the Interior Castles says that it is the most beautiful place, that it is absolutely beyond comprehension. And I always think of how beautiful that garden is when I see the picture of a little baby reaching up to God, this pure little happy baby. I think of that as the way the beauty of our soul affects God when it is in a state of grace, when our garden is pure, so to speak. So Teresa of Avila uses the garden analogy, as does Francis de Sales, John of the Cross, Thérèse of Lisieux. And in the book of her life, she gives us this incredibly beautiful understanding of progress in prayer. And by the way, it's really important for you to know, and I don't know what you believe, I think charismatics tend to be more open to this reality than other types of Catholics, but God is calling you to be a contemplative. Do y'all believe that? How many of you believe that? How many of you think it's just for priests and religious if you've got like a big gigantic beard like Father Emmanuel? How many of you think it's just for priests and religious and sisters with habits, cloistered or active? That's actually a lie of the devil. God desires for you, no matter who you are, no matter what your state of life is, no matter what your profession, no matter how many kids you do or don't have, no matter how many problems you do or don't have, no matter where you work, whether you're a man or a woman, no matter your age, His desire is for you to be in the highest union with Him in prayer in this life before you see Him face to face, so that you are prepared to see Him face to face. In John chapter 14, one of my favorite passages in the Bible, Jesus says, if you live in the covenant of love with me, now I'm translating, Jewish brain, thinking about, he said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. But that should be understood in this idea of this covenant of love. My wife and I are in a covenant of love. We've made these commitments to each other. No other woman but her. No other God but me. So you see, the commandments are really the context of what it looks like to live in a covenant of love. So I translate it that way when I summarize the passage. Jesus says, if you live in this covenant of love with me, I will manifest myself to you. Has Jesus manifest himself to you? Has Jesus manifest himself to you? Is he a liar, or is there maybe a problem? Maybe a problem. I and my Father will abide with you. One of the ways that St. Teresa sought to reveal how it is that we grow from the most basic aspects of prayer to contemplative prayer, she wrote in the book of her life, which was written, I think, in 1565 or completed at that time. And if you're going to start reading Teresa, do not start with the interior castles. You will be confused, and you'll put it down, and you'll give up. If you're going to start reading Teresa, you've got to start two places. One, the book of her life, or, I don't know if I have enough cord. I don't know. The book of her life, or this book, 30 Days with Teresa of Avila, that I wrote with Dr. Anthony Lillis. I don't make money selling books. I write books because I love you, and I love God's wisdom, and I want it to be revealed to the world. But start there. But in the book of her life, she gave this analogy of waters in the garden and how we progress in prayer. By the way, Keith, I have no clue what time it is, and I can't see anybody. So I don't know when I'm going to stop. I may stop tonight sometime, but if you do want me to stop, you're going to have to be very obvious at some point. But in the book of her life, she gave the illustration of the waters of the garden, the four waters. They're called four waters. But before we get there, there's two quotes that are very beautiful about this topic. Thérèse Lisieux said, "Let us make of our hearts a garden of delights where our sweet Savior may come and take his rest." Let us make of our heart a garden of delights where our sweet Savior may come and take his rest. That does not happen automatically. I don't know if any of you've done any gardening, but gardening is hard work. You have to tend the garden. You have to get rid of the weeds. One of the wonderful things about this analogy of water in the garden is what water is in the analogy. So what do you think water is in the analogy? What does water represent in the garden of the soul? Louder. The Holy Spirit. Grace. Right? So the more water, the more grace. The cool thing about this water, and I need tissue from somebody. The cool thing about this water is that the water of the earth does bad things and good things, right? You're wonderful. Thank you. That's what I get. Audrey made me cry, and so my nose is running. But the water of the garden of the soul never floods out roads like we had as we were driving in, never causes damage. What it does is it cleanses the soul and gives nourishment to the fruits that God wants to bring up in the soul. So the water brings up fruits, I guess, would be good. But flowers, let's say, in the garden. But the water that God brings also kills what? Weeds. And weeds are vice and sin, right? So the more time we spend in prayer, this is the magic and the secret of prayer that people don't realize. The more time we spend in prayer, this is why it has the effect of drawing us to God. Because if you ask a theologian and you say, is prayer necessary for salvation, they will say no. Theologically speaking, if they're a good theologian, they will say no, theologically speaking. Practically speaking, they will tell you, or if you talk to a spiritual theologian, they will say no theologically, but if you're not praying, Your garden is going to disarray, and you will constantly fall prey to sin, to concupiscence, to the world, the flesh, and the devil. Your vision will constantly be blurred. You'll constantly lose your way. And if you lose your way too many times, and you don't say yes to God enough, and you say no too many times because you're weakened, because in absence of prayer, you can lose your way permanently. So I say prayer is necessary for salvation in that sense. And I think that the doctors of the church would back me up. St. John of the Cross said this about the garden of the soul. The soul is the garden wherein the beloved feeds among the flowers, defended and guarded for him alone. So when Teresa gave this analogy in 1565, it was the beginning of her thinking, or early thinking on this topic. 10 years later, she finished the Interior Castle, which is her opus on prayer. It is beyond any other book in the church, the most profound book on prayer ever written. In that book, she corrected and elaborated on teachings she gave in her life. So we're going to talk about five waters instead of four, just to give a little more detail that you might get if you looked at the four waters through the lens of the Interior Castle, which she finished 10 years later and after quite a bit more experience. The first stage of prayer she illustrated and said was like someone who was drawing water from a well. So I had a friend of mine do this cool drawing of a woman drawing water from a well, and she's got a bucket in her hands. You ever drawn water from a well? I don't know how old some of you are. I'm a little older. I've done it before, and it's really a pain in the neck. You draw, and especially if you don't have a crank at the top of the well, I don't know what those things are called, but if you draw the bucket up and you're leaning over, your back hurts, it's banging against the sides. And she used that illustration to reveal that the beginning of prayer is always difficult. And this is why people don't persevere in prayer, because they don't expect the difficulties and they don't know how to overcome the difficulties. But at the beginning of prayer, you have to do all this laborious work. This is called the ascetical life. In the catechism, it talks about prayer as a battle. There are no sissies who are contemplatives. If they were sissies, they were cured of that before they became contemplatives, because they're willing to engage the battle in prayer. Why? Why would they do that? The only reason I would do it is because Jesus gave everything for me, and I have to give everything back. And I was just told I have 10 minutes, and I just started. Did you say 45? So we begin with vocal prayer, but we have to recognize it's hard. Why is it hard? Because if you decide to get up early, which is the smartest thing to do, so I'm going to get up, let's say, 10 minutes earlier than I normally do, and you get up and you set the alarm clock and you're giving that time to God, what does your body do to you when you do that? It says, what is wrong with you? I was sleeping. I'm tired. I don't feel good. I don't want to do this. Your will is weak when you get up early. So this time of prayer, it's one of the reasons why vocal prayer is the smartest thing. If you've never spent extensive time in daily prayer and made that commitment, vocal prayer is probably the best way to begin, because your mind's all hazy when you get up. It's difficult. Pray the Our Father, Hail Mary, or the Rosary, or the Liturgy of the Hours. The beginning is always very hard because your body is fighting against you. Your old habits are fighting against you. And the enemy of your soul does not want you to succeed. The last thing the devil wants you to do is go to Mass, go to reconciliation, start daily prayer, or get a spiritual director. Those are the things that I think the devil hates and worries about the most with all of you, with anyone. The second water is where we get into a little bit heavier kinds of prayer. I have a book in the back. I should have grabbed them all at once. It's by a wonderful Franciscan friar named St. Peter of Alcantara. It was written in the 16th century. He was a spiritual director of Teresa of Avila. And he talks about how the book is called Finding God Through Meditation. But it teaches discursive prayer. What does discursive mean? Discursive prayer is thinking prayer. Thinking. So you can do this, by the way, with Lectio Divina. I'm sure all of you have heard of Lectio Divina, right? Read, reflect, respond, rest. I think that's, in my opinion, if you ask my opinion about what prayer to start with, I want to go into mental prayer and dig deeper, Lectio Divina would be my number one choice, even though I'm a big fan, of course, of Ignatian prayer as well. But discursive prayer, Teresa describes that things begin to get a little easier. So this is some time in vocal prayer. It's not going to get easier for 2 months or 3 months. It's going to take longer than that. But then you want to branch out into mental prayer. Why? Because you want to begin to fill your heart and mind with God and respond to God. Oh, look at that. He's such a good man. This is finding God through meditation. This is in the back. Updated translation of St. Peter. St. Teresa of Avila, by the way, loved him and spoke of him more highly than any other person in her life. Discursive prayer begins to make things easier. So that's why we have depicted this young woman now pumping the pump into the bucket, but she's still got to carry it to the garden of her soul, so it's still kind of difficult. This is still an ascetical phase of prayer. What is ascetic? Ascesis is exercise. St. Paul said, I buffet my body and make it my slave, right? This is work. This is the battle of prayer still. But then something beautiful begins to happen. And now we have the young woman pumping water into kind of an aqueduct to her garden. And that's called affective prayer. What is affective prayer? I'll give you an analogy. Not too long ago, I was driving down my street on the way to my home, and I was thinking about my wife and how wonderful she is and how virtuous she is and how holy she is and how she had overcome so many things in her life and even since we'd been married. And my heart began to well up in love for her. And my eyes began to tear a bit, thinking about what a glorious and wonderful woman she was and how much of a blessing she is in my life. I started thinking about facts about my wife in discursive prayer. Those facts began to affect my heart. This is what meditation and mental prayer do to your heart, especially when you focus on Scripture and Christ. You begin with facts. This happened, that happened, he went here, he talked to the woman at the well. But as you learn how to pray Lectio Divina the way it should be prayed, or meditate the way that meditation should be experienced, which is all about filling your mind with God, not about emptying, never emptying. That is not Christian idea of prayer. It's all about filling the mind with God. If God decides to suspend your faculties in contemplative experience, God can do that. But for us, our choice, our will is only and always exerted in Christian prayer toward the filling of our minds and hearts with God. So that's what happens with affective prayer. And then after some time of battling with sin, if you all know the three ways, the purgative, illuminative, and unitive way, this is all purgative kind of prayer. This is the same time we're working out, we're constantly getting the weeds out of our garden of mortal sin, of venial sin, of imperfections. We're mostly mortal and venial sin and mostly habitual. And we're fighting that battle. When you begin to win the battle against habitual sin, whether it be mortal or venial, God begins to work in the soul in a new way. Where at one point affective prayer used to give you this incredible experience of God, all of these insights into Scripture, all of this encouragement. You know, when I was telling you about my wife, what I did after I got home was I decided, because I was so moved by her, to go get back in my car and go buy her flowers. This is the effect of prayer. It works virtue in our heart. It motivates us to love God even more. But there's a point at which aridity begins to creep into prayer. And we know this. If you're a spiritual director, you understand, or you understand spiritual theology, you know that that could be God calling this person to contemplation. But usually, folks get frustrated here. I remember a sister who wrote me a letter once who said that, and it brought me to tears. I was both tears of sadness and joy. Sadness because I hurt that she didn't have the guidance that she needed, and joy that we could give her the guidance she needed. But she said, I've been a nun for, I don't know what she said, 20 or 30 years, and I follow my rule of life, and I give everything to God, and I give everything that I have, and he's nowhere to me. I don't know him. He's not present to me. He's absent from me. And so the good news was to reveal to her a wonderful analogy that St. John of the Cross gives in his writings, where he says that when you enter this time of aridity, assuming that mortal and habitual mortal and venial sin have been conquered by the grace of God and your yes to God, that when you get to this point where God begins to be absent or feel absent, it's the same time where a mother sets her child down to begin to walk on his own. What is it like to be at a mother's breast for a baby? Ecstasy, right? All that wonderful skin and all of the nourishment to the soul. And you know they're in ecstasy because that's what they do when they're all done. What does the baby feel like when mama puts him down on the floor and suddenly it's cold and he feels alone? And what if the baby can't see the mama? Is the baby alone in that case? Not alone. It's just time for a different way. It's to all the consolations have been to nourish the baby and get it strong enough so that when it is set down, it can actually endure that difficulty, that aridity. And so St. John reveals that that aridity begins to reveal that prayer should change. And usually when you ask somebody during that time of prayer, what is your prayer like? They will say, well, I try to meditate and I can't make any progress. And I used to do it this way and I do it and I don't see God and I don't feel his presence and I can't sense anything. But you ask a little more and you say, well, have you ever just sat with God? And sometimes they'll say, yeah, I have. I do that. But I've got to get through my prayers. It's time to set down what once gave you great consolation and allow God to do a new work in your heart. When you're in this period of prayer where you may have before had a kind of method that you would follow, like Lectio Divina or meditation, you can come to prayer and kneel or be before the presence of the Lord and need absolutely nothing. But you may not experience him physically, but you know, because you're experiencing contemplative prayer, you know that he is present to you, and you are present to him, and you can sit there for the next half hour or hour and be in God's presence, or maybe only 5 minutes or 10 minutes. But prayer begins to simplify. And the beautiful analogy Teresa gives in this case is that God provides a stream that the woman just simply needs to divert into her garden. But this is transitional. Prayer of simplicity is a transition between mystical and ascetical prayer. And there's more to this, but the prayer of recollection begins to emerge such that there are two sides to the prayer of recollection. There's something called acquired recollection, which she reveals in her book, The Way of Perfection, and there is mystical recollection, I don't remember the other name, but it's acquired recollection and infused recollection. That's what it is. The difference is that with acquired recollection, that means that the soul has advanced to such a state that they can be any place at any time in the midst of total chaos and draw themselves into the presence of the Lord and be with him and overcome the chaos. Be separate from the chaos. Not to be dominated by any emotional trauma inside of them or any of the battles with the world, the flesh, and the devil, but have the ability to draw near to God in a very powerful way that here, down here, all they've got is monkeys in their head. They go to start praying, all the monkeys in the tree start squealing and throwing stuff around and yelling and reminding you of songs and things you have to do and people that bothered you yesterday and things you wish you would have said when that person insulted you and that guy at your work that you don't like and why did my parents do this to me? You know, that that becomes a thing of the past when you move into contemplative prayer. That doesn't mean it doesn't happen, but it means that it doesn't affect you or control you anymore. The final stage, of course, is contemplation. And this beautiful picture, of course, is the woman outstretched with her arms. Think of this as Florida rain. It's very warm rain. Into the garden, and God is just drenching the garden, not flooding, but drenching the garden with all the grace that the soul needs to rise even more, to rise even more rapidly to him, into his soul, into his heart. Saint Teresa, a beautiful quote on the garden of the soul, and I'll see if I can read it sideways. If this ground be well dug by troubles, by persecutions, distractions, infirmities, there are few who ascend so high without this. Let me just say this. I can't remember if Audrey said it on the stage here or if she said it during prayer. But she prayed a prayer that I thought was prophetic to this note, and that is that her desire, which I believe is God's desire, is that you understand that the purgation of this life is the means through which God draws you to himself. If you say yes. I was asked not too long ago to speak to the Institute on Religious Life, and they asked me to speak on the topic of why it is that religious or devout people stop growing in their prayer lives. And St. John of the Cross thankfully asks and answers that question, so I didn't have to make anything up. But he said that the reason that they stop growing is because they set down the cross. Because the cross is hard. Healing is hard. Yielding to the divine physician is hard. The amount of emotional, spiritual surgery that I've had to endure has been beyond my imagination and excruciating from beginning to end. But every time I say yes and I go into surgeries, I've had more physical surgeries than I could ever count. But every time I say yes, I go in, I come out, I'm closer to him. And every time I say no, the divine physician then no longer has the opportunity to further invade my soul with his grace and healing and draw me out of the despair and the darkness that has me bound. He wants you unbound. He wants you free. But the only way for you to be unbound and free is to say yes and never set down your cross. Never set down your cross. If this ground, the garden of your soul, be well dug by tragedies, by troubles, by persecutions, infirmities, there are few who ascend so high without this. I would say there are none. If it be well broken up, the ground of your soul be well broken up by great detachment from all self-interest, it will drink in so much water that it can hardly ever be parched again. But if the ground, which is mere waste and covered in thorns, as I was when I began, if the occasions of sin be not avoided, if it be an ungrateful soul, unfitted for so great a grace, I want to do what I want to do. Why are you bothering me again? Can't this trial be over? I want to go have fun. Stop bothering me. He will answer that prayer, by the way, every time. If it be parched up again, if the gardener becomes careless, and if our Lord, out of his mere goodness, will not send down rain upon it, the garden is ruined. Thus it has been with me more than once, and so I am amazed at it. And if I had not found it so by experience, I could not have believed it. My prayer for you, and I'll end with this, is that you say yes to God, that you lean into the pain, that you never take up his, never set down your cross. And if he, and if you will do that, he will manifest himself to you in ways that you never thought possible. You will overcome things that you never thought you could overcome. You will achieve things you never thought you could achieve. You will see and know things you never thought possible for a human being to see and know. And the God of peace will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.